Hey guys, I hope you're well. My name is Thomas Blakemore. I teach travel and sometimes triumph. And this is going to be a teach video for teachers. Due to COVID-19, many schools around the globe have closed, including mine. Now, recently I've received a lot of requests asking me different questions about what my school are doing in terms of school closures. In this video, what I wanted to do is give you a bit of an action plan to sort of explain some of the things that I'm doing within my school. One of the key things that I think is important with school closures is keeping things as simple as possible. I wanted to show you a range of software that I'm actually using, and then I wanted to sort of explain the functionality of those bits of software. At the same time, I did want to also give you a range of other bits of software that you could use, since many different subscription-based software companies have now decided that their educational services are going to be free due to the circumstances around the globe. So it's going to be a great little video to hopefully explain and give you information just in case your school closes or if you're in a position similar to me where your school has closed. So to start off with, I'm going to put a link just up here of some of the timestamps so that you can click onto those and get a bit of a shortcut through to the different bits and pieces that I'm going to be using and explaining in the video. Within each part, I'm going to talk about other little bits of software that I'm using and how that's going to benefit my classroom too. The main piece of software that I'm going to be using is G Suite. Now, G Suite is fantastic for educators. If your school have not used it, Google have said that their resources are going to be free. They released a bit of an announcement, so it's worth checking out. Now, I might be wrong with this, but for now, I believe there's certain functionality that is free. So we're going to get into it and explain how I'm using Google Classroom to implement and assign Google Docs, Google Slides, Google Forms, lots of different Google things.
Okay, so this is a screencast showing what I'm going to be getting up to with my class. Now, to do that, I'm on a MacBook at the moment, so you can see QuickTime Player. If you press File, New Screen Recording, you need to allow the audio so that you can actually pick up your voice. That's going to be great if you've created a flip chart and you want to talk through that flip chart as if you're teaching in person. I've said in a previous video about safeguarding teaching live. It can be good, but at the same time, you've got to think about safeguarding and what the children are seeing too. There's other resources to use. If you've not got a MacBook, that's fine. You can use Screencastify. I believe it's free at the moment, so that's also something that you can use too. There's other resources that are exactly the same and function similarly. So this is Google Classroom. Now, if we start up here, this is what the kids call the waffle. There's loads of different applications. You'll probably be most familiar with Gmail, and it's something that the children all have. Classroom is what I'm currently showing you. Docs is what the children are most likely to be completing Word documents on. Sheets, that's like Excel. Slides is another thing that the children are going to be using quite frequently. I'm not going to talk through all of these because it's quite simple to explain. Calendar, that's another thing that's going to be quite beneficial just for me to see when work is going to be completed by. And you've also got Forms. Now, Forms is fantastic, almost like a quiz, so I can set work and allow children to complete a quiz so that they can set that and I'm able to see responses. So that's quite good in that way too. So I want to show you the functionality of Google Classroom. So this is my Google Classroom at the moment, 3E remote learning, and there's lots of different things you can see straight away. Here, share something with your class. It's a bit like a Facebook feed. I can just share a notification. If I click on that, then I can set things for all students and just share a resource. Now that's not an assignment, so that's slightly different. If I was to click add, that would show you lots of different bits and pieces that I can add in. I can add in a Google Drive link, just a general website link, a YouTube video, like my own, and I can add in a file too. I can add that to all students, or if I click on that, which I'm not going to do because it'll show you all the students, I can then add in work for each individual child, but you're not likely to do that. On classwork, that's where things get interesting. You can see all of the different topics down the side, registration, spelling, English, reading, all of them. I can set work through into each individual topic, so that's going to be great in that way. If I were to click on to create, this is where I can create an assignment, quiz, question. I can just show material, or I can reuse a post from before. If I click on assignment, this is where things are great, because then I can set work. So example, instructions, complete this. And then from here, I can do lots of different things basically. So I can just put a due date. So just set when this needs to be due by. So let's put that. I can set it for all students or individuals. Then I can go through to, let's say, music and assign that. Now, I've not shown you that you can add things and link things in, but then you'll see that music, and there's an example piece of work, and the children will access that and then be able to hand in a piece of work. Now, here's one I made earlier, and you can see here, this is an example of the journey story starter, and this is something that the children have already completed. So you can see 3 children have handed it in, 15 have got it assigned. So this is a piece of work that one of the children have already completed, and they've done a range of different bits and pieces with this, which I'm really proud of. From here, what I really like, and this is a strong point of Google Classroom, is you can do things live. So if the child was also on this at the moment, I would be able to say something along the lines of, this is great, now add more similes. ... Okay, so we've added some feedback straight away that the child will be able to see. At the same time, I can add private comments in. So I could add in, amazing, this is almost finished, and then post that, and then eventually return that back to the child so that they can finish it slightly later on. This is a great example of using Google Slides to complete work. So I feel like this is a general whistle-stop tour of Google Classroom. There is so much more functionality, and I feel like I've not really done this justice, but I just wanted to show you it. I think the key really is keeping Google Classroom simple rather than setting lots of different work. So I wanted to show you other bits and pieces and resources that I'm also going to be using with my class. So this is Study Ladder. This is one of my favorite resources for setting different activities. They've got over 47,000 resources on this website that you can set. So I'm just going to explore it with you guys very quickly so that you can see what goes on involved with this one. So you've got resources and you've got tasks. You can see what activities I've already set for my children. So if I were to click onto prep for school closure, there wasn't one on a previous activity. You can see all of the different pods that I've set. To do that, you create a new pod down in the corner. Let's do this now. Example, set for class, year 3 maths, create. Now there's groupings as well, so you can create your own groups and things like that so that it's easier to set work for specific individuals. Where to start? So let's pretend we're doing an addition lesson. I teach year 3, so we're gonna go year 3, addition. I'm gonna do adding 10 problem solving. That always seems to be a problem. And the activities, they're fantastic. They look a little bit like this when the internet decides to work. So starting point, Jim has 63 sheep. He buys 10 more. How many does he have? We're gonna say, 73. Instant feedback. So they immediately get that feedback. Let's just type anything, 57. Oh no, it's giving them the correct answer. What's nice about this is they can come back to those things. So they get that instant feedback too. Eventually we get results. Now, I'm obviously not gonna show you children's names, but you can see this child here, for example, has answered 27 of them. Of those, struggled with some of them, 56 of them he's got correct. So that's some instant feedback and assessment that I've got there too. So that's great. Learning by questions is another good resource that the year 6 teachers in my school use. It's great for SAT and setting custom questions that you can customize. You get instant feedback once you've set up tests. There's also a range of resources that are available on there too. So I definitely recommend this one, guys, if you're in the upper key stage 2. We're gonna look into some of the younger year groups using Purplash, and in the time that I've got, I'm not going to do this justice, but there's so many different bits and pieces that you can do with this. So you've got to-dos where you can set work and activities. I'm sure you'll be able to find tutorial videos for how to use this. It's fantastic with key stage 1. You've got a range of different tools that you can use with the children. So if I were to click onto that, you'll see to create a story, I've used that quite frequently. To publish, use that quite frequently with key stage 1-2. The code in here is quite good and is quite walkthrough so that the children are able to use that quite easily. Got nice little bits and pieces here, tools that the children can use. You've also got a search bar here. Now there's so many different resources. Sometimes it's hard to find the resources that you need, but in year 3 we were doing Stone Age. So if I just type in Stone Age, you can see up here I've searched Stone Age, and there's a range of different materials that you could potentially use. If we click on the Stone Age folder, you'll see a range of different materials. writing projects all across here, and painting materials that we could click on. Now, if I were to launch app, you can see straight away what's come up. So this is something that the children could just really have fun with and submit to you through the to-dos. Easily done. So that's Purple Mash in a nutshell. Let's go on to the next resource.
Seesaw is another similar learning resource. However, I do know that their resource is free, which is fantastic. And it's usually free, and there's lots of functionality with the free resource that you can use additionally. So we're going to get into that part and show you lots of different functionality with Seesaw too. Right now you can see we're on Seesaw. Seesaw is a fantastic application, similar to Google Classroom. What I like about Seesaw is that the children can see each other's work. That way it's a bit motivational, so that they can see if another child's working, they're more likely to be motivated to do that. Google Classroom is fantastic because you can see the work that the children are doing live, so you can give that feedback live. So those are the pros and cons against each ones. So let's get into Seesaw and different ways that this can be used. To start off with, you can see we're on Journal. This is a journal of all the different work that has been completed before. You can see we're on an example class, so you can see the different children and the activities that have been completed before. So child one, child two, falling behind, child three, and child four on it. So that's the journal element, and you can see existing history of work. We're going to go on to folders because we're going to set something up. So if we manage folders, we'll be able to create a new folder. Today we're just going to have a science and a maths. So we've got a maths already, so we're going to set up a science bit here. So that one's done. Activities is fantastic because that way you can set activities, and we're going to get into that. Inbox is also really good because that way you can communicate with parents. So we're going to get straight into activities. Skills we don't need to worry too much about. Activities. So you can see there's already an existing piece of work that's been set before. We're going to add work. Post-student work, that's where children have completed something and they can send it into you, so you can post it onto your journal feed. And assign activity. You can see in assign activity there's a range of different bits of work. Now this one here by Mrs. Perham, that's already been set. Now Mrs. Perham has nothing to do with that, that's just a teacher somewhere in the world. And what I really like about Seesaw is there's a range of activities already. If I wanted to do something with science, so let's say I wanted to do something with forces. I want to change the grade to grade 3 or 4. And you can see here, there's a range of different pieces of work. At the moment, I'm doing magnets, so I'm going to heart it because that saves it for me. I can then come back to my library and you can see Erica Carter. Thank you, Erica. You've just completed my work for today. I'll obviously check it and go through the teacher bits and pieces. So as I assign it, I'm going to assign it to my sample classroom. I'm going to schedule it because I want it to be completed on a specific date and time. I don't want that in until I'm not too bothered. So that's assigned. I'm going to set it into folders, assign. So now you can see that is set up correctly. So now we're able to see different pieces of work that the children are able to do. You can see that a task has already been set. If I click on this 5 responses, 0 waiting for approval, here you'll see that there's different pieces of work that children have done. I can see that child one's made a conscious effort towards it, child two falling behind, so let's click on child one. So you can see here, great effort so far. I can also add a comment, you can see there's one being added already. Add text in towards myself, and there's lots of different things that I could potentially do, and then I can add those bits to different folders. Now as you can see, this is an English piece of work, so I'm less likely to add it to those, but as and when that science piece of work comes around, then I can add it to the correct folders once completed. So there's more that you can do with Seesaw, but for now I'm just going to leave it at that so that you can actually go and set activities for a class that you've set up yourself. So as you can see, I've hopefully covered the majority of the bases that I'm going to need to as and when I start home learning in the future through the use of Google Classroom, Study Ladder, Purple Mash, a range of other resources too. I'm going to raid a range of different resources now that are now free due to school closures because of COVID-19. I think two tips are really important here. Number one, please do not reinvent the wheel. I know a lot of schools are suggesting that we create paper packs that the children might try and complete at home. But that's going to involve a lot of creation and making resources. You don't want to overwhelm your parents and students by giving too many resources because it's going to confuse people. So that's important too. So there's that. I know I have this YouTube channel, so it's great because I can create videos quite efficiently, but at the same time, it takes a long, long time. So really try and think about using videos that already exist on YouTube. That's important because it's going to save you time, time that you can be using to try and give live feedback if you're using Google Classroom or just create other resources. I'm sure there's going to be so many things that you need to do when implementing a home learning strategy. I'm going to read through a range of resources that are now free. I'm going to specifically highlight resources that I've used in the past, things that I might not have thought about for the video and shown you, but things that you might want to think about due to the way that I've used them in the past. Too simple. Too simple is to do with Purple Mash, so that's something that's free. You've got Age of Learning, Albert, Alchemy, American Chemistry Society Pack, Backpack Sciences, Board Maker, which is an app to create almost like board games, Book Creator app, that's fantastic because you can create a range of different work. Breakout Edu, I've heard of that one. Buncee, Sentry. Now Sentry is fantastic, it's an AI version of Study Ladder, so as and when children start to have misconceptions, they can start to address those through Sentry's artificial intelligence system, so that's really good too. Class Dojo, big up Class Dojo. I think there's a way of sharing work through that platform too. Classroom Secrets, one of my favorites. That's a really good resource for a range of different maths mastery resources. At the same time, you've got White Rose Maths too. They have a range of maths resources that you can start to utilize. So thank you very much for those resources for being free. You've got other resources available. Edge Puzzle, I've used that one before. Explain Everything, that's a really good one for screencasting. A similar way to screencast, so you can create something live and you can be talking through something with a pen and just sort of giving feedback. It's a nice little resource to use. Google for Edu, so as I said before, I'm hoping, fingers crossed, that it is free for you guys and you can start to use that, and really, really hoping that makes things easy for you guys. You've got Khan Academy, again, a really nice maths one that you can use similar to Study Ladder. Minecraft Education, that would be a really nice one for the children for computing. Again, there's a lot to explore with Minecraft education, so it'd be worth trying to explore it and seeing whether it suits your class. Try not to overwhelm people too much. Seesaw, so hopefully, fingers crossed, that's free. You've got, still going with this, Twinkle, another really good resource that is now free. Fantastic for parents so that they can download, print, and use their own paper resources. Really big shout out to Twinkle because I know that is quite an expensive resource sometimes. Tinker is a really good coding one, good for lots of different things like that. You've also got Typing Club, which is really good for developing typing skills, as you can tell. Vooks have been a sponsor of this channel before. Vooks create a range of different animated books. It's quite engaging for children. You might want to do some reading comprehension from that, as I've done before, and you'll be able to see that in another video up there somewhere. And you've also got Zoom, that's another really good one for, I believe, live feedback too. So as you can see, there are so many different websites and I only really scratched the surface of the different learning resources that are available, so I'll post the link down below for you guys to go and explore. Hopefully, I'm really hoping something within this video has been useful. If you've enjoyed it, if you've liked it, feel free to like it in the corner. I really appreciate you guys spending your time with this channel and hopefully learning something new. If you feel like this is something that you want to see more of, feel free to subscribe down in the corner. I make a range of teaching and traveling content, so you'll be able to see those more within my channel. Hopefully I can give more explanations, talking about the pros and cons of different apps, and hopefully talk through a bit of a vlog as and when I go through the home learning process so I can share how things have been and the problems that I've had too. I hope to see you in the next one, but for now, I'm out.